Hello everyone, this is Dr. Mohsen. Today our lecture will be on the anatomy of the cecum and the appendix, but first we will cover an introduction to the large intestine. The large intestine extends from the ileum to the anus. It is around 1.5 meters in its length. It is divided into different parts. The first part is the cecum, from which we have a diverticulum known as the appendix. Then we have the ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, the sigmoid colon, the rectum, and finally the anal canal. The rectum and the anal canal are covered in the pelvis and perineum portion of your anatomy, whereas we will cover up to the sigmoid colon over here. The primary function of the large intestine is the absorption of water and electrolytes and the storage of undigested material until it can be expelled from the body in the form of feces. Other functions of the large intestine are the absorption of vitamins, reduction of acidity, defending from various infections, and the production of various antibodies against infections. There is a very important feature of this large intestine which differentiates it from the small intestine, and that is the presence of tinea coli. So we know that the intestinal wall is basically made up of two muscle cords. One we have the circular muscle, and the second one we have the longitudinal muscle, which is going like this. But in the large intestine, the longitudinal muscle, instead of being present around the entire continuity or the entire diameter of the colon, it gets thickened to form three ribbon-like bands. So we have three ribbon-like bands of longitudinal smooth muscle in the large intestine, which are known as tinea coli. Proximally, these bands emerge from the base of the appendix. The appendix does not have any tinea coli. The cecum, the ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, and finally the sigmoid colon. All of these are the portions of the large intestine which have the tinea coli. And once we reach the terminal part of the sigmoid colon, these tinea coli, they become continuous again with the longitudinal muscle cord around the rectum. So we can just say that the longitudinal muscle cord splits in the region of the large intestine to form three thickened ribbon-like bands, and once it reaches the rectum, these muscle bands, they become continuous again as a longitudinal muscle cord around the rectum. The positions of these tinea coli are specifically important. We have an anterior tinea, an anterior band of smooth muscle, which is also known as the tinea labra. Why it is known as the tinea labra? Because it is free, it is not attached to any other structure. Then we have a posterior medial band, which is known as tinea mesocolica. It provides attachment to the mesentery of the colon or the mesocolon. And finally, we have a posterior lateral band, which is also known as the tinea omentalis. It provides attachment for the greater omentum. These positions of the tinea are present in the cecum, the ascending colon, the descending colon, and the sigmoid colon. What happens in the transverse colon is that the intestine, it gets twisted on itself. The intestine, it gets twisted on itself. So what happens is that we are going from the cecum over here to the ascending colon over here, and finally this is the portion of the transverse colon. As you can see that a twist has occurred, so now the positions of the tinea, they also change. The anterior tinea now becomes the inferior tinea labra, the posterior medial tinea now becomes the posterior tinea mesocolica, and the posterior lateral tinea now becomes the... Over here you can see the position of the tinea in this diagram. This is the appendix over here. We have the, this is the appendix over here. This is the ileum coming into the cecum. This is the cecum, and then we have the ascending colon, we have the transverse colon, we have the descending colon, we have the sigmoid colon, and finally we have the rectum over here. So you can see that we have an anterior tinea over here and over here. And also inferiorly, we cannot see it in this position, but we have a tinea over here inferiorly, and this is known as the tinea labra, the free tinea, which is not attached to any other structure. Then we have a relatively posterior medial tinea, which is known as the tinea mesocolica, and finally we have a tinea omentalis, which is present relatively on the posterior lateral aspect of the ascending, descending, and sigmoid colon, as well as the cecum. Over here you can see the position, you can see how a tinea is formed. So you can see that this is the entire wall, this is the entire section of the small large intestine. You can see that there is a thickened band of muscle over here. So this thickened band of muscle over here, this thickened band of longitudinal muscle, is the tinea. between the tinea, the large intestine, the wall of the large intestine, it becomes sacculated. And these sacculations, which you can see over here, these are known as the haustra. And finally, we have omental appendices. These omental appendices are basically fat-filled pockets which are present in the region of the large intestine. We have another diagram showing the ascending colon. We have a cut section of the ascending colon over here. So over here you can see the anteriorly we have the tinea libra. Posteromedially we have the tinea mesocolica next to the medial paracolic sulcus. And posteriolaterally we have the tinea omentalis next to the lateral paracolic sulcus. This diagram again shows the tinea libra, the tinea omentalis, the tinea mesocolica, and similar positions in the descending colon as well. Haustra, as we have said above, haustra are the sites where the colon gets puckered and sacculated because the tinea are shorter as compared to the circular muscle cord. So we can see that this is a tinea over here, and over here between the tinea, the circular muscle cord, it basically the tinea, they are shorter than the circular muscle cord. So the colon, it gets sacculated, it forms outpouchings in these regions, and these outpouchings or sacculations are known as haustra. So this is a haustra, this is a haustra, and this is an similarly these are also haustra. So appendices epiploiki are small fat-filled omental pockets which are present over the surface of the large intestine. They are not present in the appendix, the cecum, and the rectum, but they are present in all other parts of the large intestine. They are most numerous on the sides of the sigmoid colon and the posterior aspect of the transverse colon. So over here you can see this fat-filled pocket, these are appendices epiploiki. They are also known as omental appendices. There are a few differences between the small and the large intestine. We have some external differences and finally we have some internal differences. Externally, the small intestine is relatively mobile with the exception of the duodenum, whereas the ascending and the descending parts of the colon, they are fixed in their position. The caliber of the full small intestine is actually smaller as compared to the filled large intestine. So the large intestine has a wider caliber. The small intestine has a mesentery which passes downward across the midline into the right iliac fossa, with the exception of the duodenum over here. The longitudinal muscle cord of the small intestine, it again forms a continuous layer around the gut, whereas in the large intestine, with the exception of the appendix, the longitudinal muscle cord forms three thickened bands known as the tinea coli. The small intestine does not have any fatty tags or the omental appendices attached to its wall. And also the wall of the small intestine is smooth, whereas that of the large intestine is seculated and has haustra. The internal differences are that the mucous membrane of the small intestine, it has permanent folds known as plica circularis. So these plica circularis, these permanent mucous membrane folds, they are not present inside the large intestine. Finally, we have the mucous membrane of the small intestine, it has villi which are absent in the large intestine, and also we have Peyer's patches. Peyer's patches are what? They are aggregations of lymphoid tissue which are present in the mucous membrane of the small intestine, but these Peyer's patches, they are absent in the large intestine. So if you see this section, we have the small intestine over here. You can see that the wall of the small intestine is relatively smooth. We don't have any haustra, we don't have any tinea over here, we don't have any appendiceal epiploiki over here. You can see that there are folds in the mucous membrane which are known as plica circularis, and also we have masses or aggregations of lymphoid tissue known as the Peyer's patches. Whereas in the large intestine, we have the tinea coli, we have the sacculations, we have the appendices epiploiki, and the mucous membrane of the large intestine, it is smooth, it does not have any folds or villi or aggregations of lymphoid tissue. The differences between the large and the small intestines are just summarized in this table. The large intestine is wider caliber and shorter. The small intestine is narrower and relatively longer. Large intestine for the most is fixed. The greater part of the small intestine is mobile. In the large intestine, there are no villi, whereas villi are present in the mucous membrane of the small intestine. We have appendices epiploiki, tinea coli, and haustrations in the large intestine which are absent in the small intestine. Now we come to our main topic, the cecum. So the cecum is a large blind-ended sac which basically forms the commencement or the starting position for the large intestine. The location of the cecum is in the right iliac fossa. It is located above the lateral half of the inguinal ligament. So the communications, the cecum, this blind-ended pouch, it communicates superiorly with the ascending colon. On its posterior medial aspect, we have the opening for the appendix, whereas medially, we have the opening for the ileum at the level of the cecocolic junction, where the cecum becomes continuous with the ascending colon. The cecum is around 6 cm long and 7.5 cm broad. So it is one of those structures in which the width is actually greater as compared to the length of the cecum. The cecum is completely covered with peritoneum. It is a mobile structure. And the presence of peritoneal folds in the vicinity of the cecum, they create certain recesses such as the superior ileocecal, the inferior ileocecal, and the retrocecal recesses, which we will see in just a minute. The relations of the cecum are relatively important. The anterior relation of the cecum is just that there are coils of small intestine present in front of it. Sometimes we have a part of the greater omentum in front of it, and the anterior abdominal wall in the right iliac region is also an anterior relation of the cecum. Posteriorly, we have certain muscles such as the psoas and the iliacus muscle. We have the nerves, which are the femoral nerve and the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh. The tip of the appendix, as we will see in our lecture, is also commonly found behind the cecum. So these are all the posterior relations of the cecum. Two muscles, two nerves, and the tip of the appendix. And medially, or posterior medially rather, the appendix arises from the cecum. So over here in this diagram, you can see that we have this this cecum over here. We have, this is the opening for the ileum. This is the ileum over here, which is coming and opening into the cecum. And this opening, as you can see, it is at the level of the cecocolic junction, where the cecum becomes continuous with the ascending colon. Then we have the posterior medial opening for the appendix into the cecum over here. This is the opening for the appendix. You can see that we have in the cecum, in the structure of the cecum, we can see an ileocecal valve over here, where the ileum is opening into the cecum. So we have an ileocecal valve over here. We will get to the structure of this valve in just a minute. We also have an orifice of the appendix, where you can see that the internally the appendix is opening in the cavity of the cecum. Over here in this direction, in this diagram, you can see some of the structures which are forming the posterior relation of the cecum. So this is the cecum. And then we can see some of the structures which are forming its posterior relations. So we can see that there is a lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh and the femoral nerve which are present behind the cecum. We also have certain muscles such as the iliacus and the psoas. This muscle over here, this is the psoas, this is the iliacus. Similarly on this side, this is the psoas, this is the iliacus. And these muscles are also forming the posterior relations of the cecum. And finally, we have the tip of the appendix, which also is present frequently behind the cecum. The arterial supply of the cecum comes from the superior mesenteric artery. We have studied this in the large blood vessels of the gut, that the superior mesenteric artery, it gives off an ileocolic artery. And this ileocolic artery, it then divides into anterior and posterior cecal arteries. So we can see that this is the terminal part of the ileocolic, which gives off cecal branches, the anterior cecal artery and the posterior cecal artery, which go on and supply the anterior and posterior aspects of the cecum. The venous drainage is by cecal veins, which drain into the ileocolic vein. The ileocolic veins, they drain into the superior mesenteric vein, which combines with the splenic vein to form the portal vein. We have covered this already. The lymphatic drainage of the cecum, it passes through several mesenteric lymph nodes and finally it passes through several different mesenteric nodes and it finally reaches the superior mesenteric lymph nodes. The nervous supply is from the superior mesenteric plexus, which derives from the T11 to L1 nervous levels, and T11 to L1 sympathetic levels, and the parasympathetic nerve supply is from the vagus nerve to the cecum. The ileocecal junction. Now, this ileocecal junction, it is the terminal, it is the point where the terminal part of the ileum, it enters the large intestine. And where it enters the large intestine, it enters at the level of the cecocolic junction, where the cecum becomes continuous with the ascending colon. So the opening over here, this opening is provided with two folds or lips. And these two folds or lips, they form the ileocecal valve. So basically, the ileocecal valve is basically formed by two horizontal folds of mucous membrane which are projecting around the orifice of the ileum. Now, this valve is very important. This valve does not play a role in the prevention of reflux of the cecal contents into the ileum. We will see what the function of this valve is in just a minute. This valve does not play any role in the prevention of reflux. Then we have a sphincter, which is a circular muscle at the lower end of the ileum, known as the ileocecal sphincter. This serves as a sphincter and it controls the flow of contents from the ileum into the colon. So basically, the ileocecal junction, we have the ileocecal valve and the ileocecal sphincter. The ileocecal valve does not play any role in the prevention of reflux, whereas the ileocecal sphincter, it controls the rate at which the contents they are going to flow from the ileum into the colon. When the cecum becomes distended, the smooth muscle tone of this sphincter is reflexively increased, whereas the hormone gastrin, which is produced by the stomach, it causes relaxation of the muscle tone and passage of contents from the ileum into the cecum. So the ileocecal valve, the structure of this valve is that it has two lips and it has two frenula. So the upper lip is relatively horizontal. It lies at the level of the ileocolic junction, where the ileum becomes continuous with the ascending colon. And the lower lip is longer and it is relatively concave. It lies at the level of the ileocecal junction. Where the two lips fuse with each other, there we have the frenula. So we have one frenula which is present anteriorly or on the left side, and we have another frenula which is present posteriorly or on the right side. The main function of this valve is that it controls the rate through the ileocecal sphincter at which the contents of the ileum pass into the cecum. It does not prevent any reflux of contents. Distension of the cecum, as we have studied, it can close the valve due to contraction of the smooth muscles. It is also actively closed by sympathetic nerves, which cause tonic contraction of the ileocecal sphincter in this region. Over here you have the structure of the valve. Over here you have, this is the terminal ileum, which is opening into the cecum. We have the orifice for the appendix over here, which is relatively posterior medial to the opening for the ileum. You can see that there are two recesses. There are peritoneal reflections over here, and these peritoneal reflections, they form folds. These folds are the superior ileocecal fold and the inferior ileocecal fold. Over here you can see that where this at the ileocecal junction, we have the ileocecal valve and we have two lips of the valve. So you can see that we have two lips of this valve over here, and where these lips meet with each other, there we have the frenulum. So we have one of these frenulum which is anteriorly or on the left side, and we have another one which is posteriorly or on the right side. This is better demonstrated in this diagram, where you can see that the upper lip is horizontal, the lower lip is relatively concave. Where these lips meet with each other, we have the left anterior cecal frenulum and we have the right posterior cecal frenulum over here. The function is that basically the pressure or chemical irritation in the cecum, it will inhibit peristalsis of the ileum and it will close the sphincter. Whereas if there is pressure or chemical irritation in the ileum, it will relax the sphincter and it will excite peristalsis, and the fluidity of the contents which are present in the ileum, it also promotes the emptying of the contents from the ileum into the cecum. The next structure which we are going to cover is the appendix. So the appendix is a worm-like diverticulum which is basically arising from the posterior medial wall of the cecum. It is a narrow muscular tube which contains a large amount of lymphoid tissue, and for this reason it is also known as the abdominal tonsil. We have the tonsils in your throat which contain a large amount of lymphoid tissue, and the appendix also contains a large amount of lymphoid tissue, so it is known as the abdominal tonsil. The length of the appendix is variable. It varies in length from 8 to 13 centimeters. Whereas the diameter of the appendix is around 5 cm. The average length is around 9 cm for the appendix. The lumen of the appendix is relatively small, and in mid-adult life it can be partially or completely obliterated. The base of the appendix is attached to the posterior medial surface of the cecum, and its detachment is around 1 inches or 2 to 2.5 cm below the ileocecal junction. The remainder of the appendix is not attached, it is free. And mobile present in the peritoneal cavity. The appendix has a complete peritoneal covering, and this peritoneal covering it is attached to the mesentery of the small intestine by a short mesentery of its own, known as the mesoappendix. This mesoappendix contains the appendicular vessels and the appendicular nerves. So over here you can see the cecum. You can see that we have the appendix, the base is attached to the posterior medial aspect of the cecum, the tip of and the rest of the appendix is free. And finally we have this mesoappendix, which is attaching it to the mesentery of the small intestine over here. The location of the appendix. The appendix is mainly located in the right iliac fossa, and its relation to the anterior abdominal wall, its base is situated around one third of a line joining the right anterior iliac superior iliac spine to the umbilicus, McBurney's point. We will see what McBurney's point is in just a minute. Inside the abdomen, the base of the appendix can be easily found by identifying the tinea coli of the cecum. So once we find the tinea coli of the cecum, we just need to trace them back to the base of the appendix. Over here, these tinea coli, they converge and they form a continuous longitudinal muscle cord. We studied in the large intestine that the tinea, they converge proximally at the base of the appendix, and over here they form a continuous longitudinal muscle cord, and this is a point of identification for the appendix. The tip of the appendix is subject to considerable range of movement, and it can be found in a lot of different positions. It can be found in the pelvis, hanging against the right pelvic wall. It can be found relatively coiled up behind the cecum. It can be found projecting upwards along the lateral side of the cecum. It can also be found either in front of or behind the terminal part of the ileum. The most common positions are these ones, the pelvic position and the retrocecal position. So here you can see the different positions of the appendix. We can have a retrocecal appendix, we can have a pelvic appendix where the tip is hanging down against the right pelvic wall. We can have a pre-ileal, which means that it is lying in front of the terminal ileum, or a post-ileal lying in behind the terminal ileum. And we can also have a subcecal appendix, which is projecting upwards along the lateral side of the cecum. These positions of the appendix, they can also be compared with the hands-on clock position. One thing that you need to know is that whenever in your exam they ask you for the positions of the appendix, you need to name different positions according to their names. That you need to write that there is a pre-cecal appendix, there is a paracecal appendix, there is a retrocecal appendix, there is a pre-ileal and a post-ileal appendix, there is a pelvic appendix. You need to write these positions. You do not need to mention the clock positions. Only the clock positions. You need to write the clock positions as well as the names. The names are more important as compared to the clock positions. So over here you can see that the retrocecal position, this is at a 12 o'clock position. This is the most common position, around present in around 65% of the cases. It is also known as the retrocolic position as well. The second positions, which is the most common, is the pelvic position. So over here, this is the pelvic position. It can either be at a 4 o'clock or a 5 o'clock. And this is the second most common position, present in around 31% of the people or the population. Then we have certain other positions. We have the pre-ileal position or the post-ileal position. These positions can either both be present at 2 o'clock, or we can have the pre-ileal at 1 o'clock and the post-ileal at 2 o'clock. They are relatively less frequent, only occurring in about 1% and 0.4% of the people respectively. We have a paracolic position or a paracecal position. The paracecal or paracolic position is the 11 o'clock position, present in around 2% of the people. And another position is the midinguinal position, which is the straight 6 o'clock position, presenting towards the obturator foramen. So over here you can see the different positions of the appendix. We have the retrocecal or the retrocolic position. We have the paracolic position at 11 o'clock. We have the splenic or the pre-ileal and post-ileal positions at 2 o'clock. We have the pelvic position at 4 or 5 o'clock. And we also have a promonteric position, which is corresponding to the brim of the pelvis at 3 o'clock. The appendicular orifice is the opening of the appendix into the cecum. This is situated on the posterior medial aspect of the cecum, 2 to 2.5 centimeters below the ileocecal orifice. And over here, this is guarded by a fold of the mucous membrane, a semilunar fold of the mucous membrane, which is known as the valve of Gerlach. It is the surface marking of this is done by making a 0.2 centimeters below the junction of the transtubercular and right lateral planes. So we have the transtubercular plane over here, we have the right lateral plane over here, and 2 centimeters below the junction of these planes, we have the appendicular orifice. Exactly at the junction of these planes, we have the ileocolic orifice. The vasculature is by the appendicular artery, which is a branch of the posterior cecal artery, which is, as we know, is a branch of the ileocolic artery. So the ileocolic gives off the posterior cecal, which gives off the appendicular artery. The venous drainage is through the appendicular veins, which drain into the posterior cecal vein. The lymphatic drainage of the appendix is either directly to the ileocolic lymph nodes or indirectly through appendicular nodes, which lie in the mesoappendix, to the superior mesenteric nodes. The nerve supply is parasympathetic from the vagus nerve, whereas the sympathetic nerve supply is from the T9 to T10 segments through the celiac plexus and finally the superior mesenteric plexus. So this is a very important point of referred pain over here in the appendix, that the efferent nerve fibers, which are concerned with the conduction of the visceral pain from the appendix, they accompany the sympathetic nerves. And these pain fibers, they enter the spinal cord at the level of the 10th thoracic segment. So we know that the 10th thoracic segment, the dermatome at this level, this corresponds to the umbilicus. So this is the reason that since the afferent nerve fibers, they enter the spinal cord at the level of the 10th thoracic segment, so the referred pain of appendicitis is to the umbilicus early in the course of the disease. McBurney's point is basically the point which overlies the base of the appendix. It is the surface marking for the base of the appendix, and it is also a very important point because, as we studied in the incisions, in the abdominal incisions, whenever we need to do an appendectomy, we choose the McBurney's point before we make an incision. So to identify the McBurney's point, we draw a line from the anterior superior iliac spine to the level of the umbilicus. At the junction of the lateral 1/3 and the medial 2/3 of this line, we have the McBurney's point. This McBurney's point is also the site of the maximum tenderness in case of appendicitis. Finally, we come to various clinical correlates of the appendix. So the appendix has two very, very important clinical conditions. The appendix is predisposed to infection because of a number of conditions, and there are also a number of factors that predispose to the appendix getting burst or perforated, as well as becoming gangrenous. As gangrene means that the appendix, the wall of the appendix has died, the appendicular muscular tissue has died. So there are a number of factors which predispose it to perforation and gangrene, and a number of factors which predispose it to infection. The predisposing factors for infection are that the appendix is long, narrow, it is blind-ended, and since it is blind-ended, so the contents of the large bowel sometimes can enter it and they stay over here. The second part is that there is a large amount of lymphoid tissue in the wall, which again predisposes it to infection. And finally, sometimes hardened intestinal contents known as enterolithes or fecolithes, they can enter into the lumen of the appendix. We said that the lumen is already very small, and when these hardened intestinal contents, they enter the lumen, they can obstruct it, and all of these features, they can predispose it to infection. Whenever there is an infection of the appendix, then there is inflammatory edema. What happens is that the wall, it becomes swollen, and since the wall becomes swollen, the blood supply of the appendix is compressed, and this can lead to stoppage of blood flow through the appendicular artery. The appendicular artery, which is a branch of the posterior cecal artery, it is an end artery. It does not anastomose with any other arteries. And if we have any edema or any other factor which is causing compression of this appendicular artery, then the blood supply to the appendix will be cut off. And once the blood supply of the appendix is cut off, it will become necrosed and gangrenous, and this can result in perforation. Perforation of the appendix or transmigration of bacteria through the inflamed appendicular wall will then result in infection of the peritoneum of the greater peritoneal sac. Now we'll take a brief look at the referred pain of appendicitis. The visceral pain in the appendix is produced by the distension of its lumen or spasm of its muscle. So this, we have already said that the afferent pain fibers, they enter the spinal cord at the level of the 10th thoracic segment. And this is the same reason why a vague referred pain is sometimes felt in the region of the appendix, umbilicus. Once initially, this is the visceral pain which we feel in the level of the umbilicus, and then this pain shifts to where the appendix is irritating the parietal peritoneum. So now the pain becomes somatic in nature, And it is now referred to the McBurney's point, which is the site of maximum tenderness in appendicitis. The pain over here is precise, it is severe and localized. Now we'll come to a certain test which we can do in appendicitis. We have the psoas and the obturator test. The psoas test becomes positive when we have a retrocecal appendix. Because why? Because the retrocecal appendix is in direct contact with the psoas major muscle. When we have inflammation of the appendix, the muscle goes into spasm. Now this muscle is a flexor of the thigh at the hip joint. So when we have a flexed thigh and we try to extend it, the muscle which is in spasm, it becomes stretched, and due to this stretch there is pain. And this pain suggests a positive psoas test and inflammation of the retrocecal appendix. So we have a flexed thigh, when we try to extend our right thigh, the psoas becomes stretched and we feel pain. The second test is the obturator test, which becomes positive in the case of a pelvic appendix. When we flex our thigh and medially rotate it, the obturator internus muscle becomes stretched. And due to this stretching, pain is felt when we have an inflamed pelvic appendix. This is all from our lecture. Finally, this is your assignment. A 17-year-old boy was brought to the hospital with complaints of acute pain around the umbilicus, fever and vomiting. On examination, the surgeon found that the area of maximum tenderness was at the McBurney's point. The psoas test was found to be positive. So, which is the involved organ and why is it predisposed to infection and gangrene? You need to give the surface markings of the McBurney's point and its importance. You need to name the different positions of the affected organ, especially the most common position. You need to describe the arterial supply of the affected organ. And you need to describe the basis of acute pain around the umbilicus. You also need to draw the different positions of these appendix over here. That's all from our lecture. Thank you so much.